So I'll present an overview of the CST and the CTO situation. But first, a little bit of history. I wanted, with this first slide, to show the tree tapping activity in Portugal in the earlier times. But I have been told, actually, this picture was taken in the south of France. So I apologize for that, but nevertheless, to be mentioned is that the tree tapping techniques in Portugal has been imported from France, from the south of France, in the late 19th century. The more ancient document that was found in Portugal relative to naval store business is dated 1475. When the Earl of Villarreal was granted by the king a license to operate the Leiria pine forest and collect the rosin extract mainly for naval store. At that time, the Portuguese started to sail all over the world. They settled in, for instance, in Macau in the early 16th century, and there was an important need of pine extract for the waterproofing of the ships. Nevertheless, during centuries, the production in Portugal, remained very rudimentary and far from covering the needs. And Portugal was still depending on imports. And it's only in 1790 that the demand of the Marquess of Pombal, you have seen his statue also in the main square of Lisbon, the first ovens on the model of the ones used in Italy, in Sicily, in Ragusa, were installed to produce pine resin. You can see a small picture of this type of oven. It's very simple. You have the wood logs are piled vertically. Then by heating, the pine extract are flowing down at the bottom. Later on, in 1822, they were replaced by the more efficient cylindrical metal ones. But it's only the second half of the 19th century, as I mentioned, that the tree tapping techniques, modern tapping techniques, were introduced in Portugal, coming from the south of France. To be mentioned are two guys, Sebastián Betamio de Almeida. He was a chemistry teacher, and Bernardine José Gómez was working with the Forest Authority of Marina Grande, and they are really at the origin of the rosin industry in Portugal. They traveled to France, especially Sebastian, and they went back and made the first trials of tree tapping trials in Leiria pine tree forest. And finally, in 1861, following these trials, these successful trials, the first modern plant to produce rosin and turpentine was built in Marina Grande. Here is the picture on the right side of the building of this first plant. Just in the middle is the fish market. And the building actually is still existing in Marina Grande. It has been converted into a museum for glasswork, which is also a traditional activity of this region, and an auditorium. That's the inside of the factory. And the factory ceased its activity in 1914. But of course, at that time, other factories developed to produce rosin and turpentine. A few words about the production in Portugal in the history. From the first plant till the beginning of the 20th century, the production in Portugal was growing, but just slowly. To finally reach 40,000 tons of rosin in 1935, then the Portuguese producer improved the quality, and really the production started to increase steadily. To reach a peak in around 1975 during 3 years of more than 100,000 tons, and then a sharp decline due to labor cost and competition from China. At the peak, Portugal was producing around 25,000 tons of gum turpentine also. Nowadays, around 9,000 to 10,000 tons of raw gum are collected in Portugal. About the gum turpentine production, I estimate the production worldwide to 145,000 tons. China representing still the main volume, with up to 80,000 tons, while the figures are between 70 to 80,000 tons. It's only half of the production 10 years ago. On the other hand, Brazil production is growing in Brazil. Now for the CST production, 205,000 tons with a yield of 3 to 5 kilos of ton per of softwood kraft pulp. North America representing the, of course, the main volume. Just to mention, I am including in those figures CST coming from CTO fractionation. Difficult to get accurate figures. Theoretically, you could get up to 30 to 40,000 tons, but I estimate that no more than 20,000 tons are really recovered and sold to the market. Few words about the fractionation capacity, 245,000 tons. A capacity in use, 205,000 tons, which is equivalent to actually the available CST. USA, 140,000 tons of capacity with four plants from IFF, Renaissance, DRT, and Creton. France, only DRT. India, it's Privy, of course. I am a bit pessimistic. I indicate 30,000 tons, but I think it's closer to 40,000 tons in India, the fractionation capacity. And in the rest of the world, the 25,000 tons with three plants in Chile, mainly Chile and New Zealand, and a smaller one in Russia. I have also been told that in China, some users might be able to fractionate a little bit of CST, but without Delta Squicarene, but I am not sure that it's really accurate. The turpentine demand around 350,000 tons, which correspond to the total turpentine production. So I would say that basically the demand is in balance with the offer. In USA, of course, it's still the highest demand with 120,000 tons. In France, 40,000. China, 90,000, India, 60,000. And those two countries, especially India, one of the main demand is coming from the production of camphor. And the rest of the world, 40,000 tons. Now, a few words about the composition of turpentine, the main components. I am showing only alpha, beta pinene, and delta squicarene, because the economic value of turpentine is based on the content of alpha and beta, and delta squicarene has a negative impact on the economic value. Decades ago, there was much higher demand for the delta squicarene because it was used, for instance, for the production of insecticide, delta mistrine. There was a big plant in France. It was also used in France as a chain stopper for the production of hydrocarbon resins. But those two plants have shut down, and now most of the delta squicarene volume is just sold as a solvent. I know only one company in the world that is still upgrading delta squicarene. So delta squicarene actually a negative impact on the economic value of the turpentine. Also, for the as far as the CST is concerned, the sulfur content is important because it's 1 to 5% as an average. It has to be eliminated and it has a cost. So it has a cost. The figures I am mentioning are only really average figures because you can have huge variation in the same area and with the same species of tree. For instance, if you take in China the Pinus yunanensis, I indicate 60% of alpha pinene, but it's actually varying from 40 to 80, 40 to 78, and the beta-pinene content is varying from 15 to 40. So that's just average figure because there are huge variations. CTO production, 2 million of tons, 40 to 60 kilo of, per ton of softwood kraft pulp. Just to mention that the demand of softwood kraft pulp is growing around 3 to 4% per year in the world, following the demand of the packaging industry with the development of e-commerce. Also following the demand for the production of tissues and hygiene products. You can see that almost 90% of the production is located in North America, Europe, and Russia. There are almost no production in Asia. The CTO demand per market segment. Fortunately, fractionation represents almost 80% of the demand. Biofuel, 12%. There are some projects that I will present later on to increase the production of biofuels. The CTO fractionation capacity, 1.8 million tons, lower than the CTO production, and capacity in use, I estimate around 1.5 million of tons. USA, the fractionation capacity is 700,000 tons. If you compare this figure with the CTO production in US, which is in North America, which is around 1 million of tons, you can see easily that there is some room for exports of CTO from US. And five plants and now only two players. In Europe, capacity of 800,000 tons, extra demand exceeding the production, so that means that exports are needed. In Russia, there are four plants in activity, the fifth one that is stopped. China, two small plants, another one, smaller one, that is working only time to time. Japan, one plant, and of course, South Africa and New Zealand. As I mentioned in the former slide, USA is by far the main CTO exporter. That's where the CTO is production is exceeding the demand. Those figures are based on the custom statistic, which is not easy to interpret. I went more in detail in last year's figures, and I have revised down the figures I presented last year. Nevertheless, this year I estimate that, this year in 2017, I estimate that it represented 110 million of US dollars and up to 250,000 tons. And of course, CTO is going to the main countries where there are CTO fractionation. The other main export, it's more just an European business because there are some exchanges between the countries, but going to the CTO fractionation plant and some exchanges between Sweden and Finland, Finland to Sweden, Russia and Poland to, of course, Finland, Austria. So it's really, it's much smaller than the US export, and it's really, it stays in Europe. The pulp and the CTO development. Between 2015 and 2020, around 4 billion US dollars are invested in pulp mills in Finland and Sweden, resulting in additional 150,000 tons of crude tallow. There are also new pulping projects in Brazil, USA, and Russia. And according to the info given by RICE, if all the projects materialized, there could be up to 300,000 tons of additional CTO during this period, 2015-2020. Among all the projects, just I wanted to mention the biggest one. It's in Finnpulp in Finland. They are now starting the engineering process. Chinese company Hengan International is a Chinese tissue producer, giant company, using 500,000 tons of softwood kraft pulp. Has to acquire a stake in Finnpulp with the aim to increase up to 49%. And now they are starting the engineering process, and only this plant could produce up to 60,000 tons of crude alloy. In 2021, the crude alloy demand for biofuel will increase, I would say, unfortunately, with the project of SCA and ST1 partnership to build a new facility to produce biofuels using 100,000 tons of crude alloy and plan to be operational in 2021. And also Sunpine planning a 50% capacity increase, operational in 2020, but that will bring additional rosin to the market, which is a good news. TOFA production, 460,000 tons. It is quite small compared to the other vegetable oils. For instance, palm oil production is now 70 million of tons. It was only 40 million in 1985. You can see the sharp growth. Growing demand for palm oil, 3 million of tons per year. And production, there is a huge yield because the yield is around 4 tons per hectare. Nevertheless, now the production of palm oil can be slowed down because of the growth can be slowed down because of the lack of lands and also environmental concern, and especially concerning deforestation. For instance, in France, there is a huge project of biorefinery, which is which will use 300,000 tons of palm oil, but with a lot of demonstration against this project. Also, the TOFA production compared to soybean oil. Soybean oil is nowadays 55 million of tons. In 1985, it was 40 million. The yield is lower than for the per hectare, is much lower than for the palm oil because it's only 600 kilos per hectare. But of course, we have to insist on the advantages of the TOFA with a lower carbon footprint and not competing with the food chain. Just about a few words about the market segments for the TOFA use. Coatings with alkyds, solvent-based alkyds is the main market segment, representing more than 40%. But as a solvent-based product, it's not a growing segment. Hopefully, some water-based alkyd will develop and increase the TOFA use in this field. Lubricity improvers, that's also one of the main markets, but I will present later on the situation of the diesel production, production of diesel in the future. So that means that it's still a growing segment, but probably in a few years it might be a bit declining. Other segments, like we can mention the growing one, and like oil field, especially in this moment in North America with the shale gas and oil extraction, it's a very dynamic field, and also dimer production. Global rosin production, 1.2 million of tons. Good news this year, because finally the gum rosin production is increasing with the development in Brazil, with a steady growth. Also, lots of Chinese projects in Africa, Madagascar starting tree-tapping, also in the Zimbabwe, Kenya, some other countries, Chinese companies are investing a lot to, and they have, are aiming to produce, well, relatively big volume of rosin. So let's hope that it will this will materialize. Global tall rosin production, so as I mentioned, 350,000 tons. With the Sun Pine project, it will be at least 15,000 tons additional in 2020. And USA representing almost half of the volume. Also to be noted that the crude tallow in US has a higher percentage of tar than in Europe, than in Scandinavia. The global resin production, 2.6 million of tons. Of course, the bad news is that hydrocarbon resins are becoming commodities. Thank you. Are becoming commodities. For instance, if you end taking market share to resin derivatives, for instance, here I'm making a rough calculation. At the peak in China, the gum rosin production was 800,000 tons, with almost 250,000 tons of exports. That means the domestic demand in China for rosin around 550,000 tons, or even between 550,000 to 600,000 tons. Nowadays, the production in China is maximum 450,000 tons. The import and the exports are balanced. So that means that the domestic demand is now only 450,000 tons. That means that in China, the rosin derivatives have lost more than 100,000 tons compared to, and of course, it's not lost for everyone. It has been hydrocarbon resin have taken this, this share. Rosin now, market of 1.2 million of tons. Regarding the segments, the adhesive segment is still the growing segment, representing about 40% of the rosin demand, mainly for rosin esters. Then inks and coatings, paper sizing and rubber are unfortunately not No, it's this one just to comment. inks and coatings, paper sizing and rubber are other segments, but not growing. So it's really the effort that has to be made in the adhesive field. Title of this slide, From Dieselgate to Diesel Crash. Everyone has heard about the Dieselgate in 2015, started with Volkswagen. That's the slide is showing the number of vehicles sold in Europe, cars and light utility vehicles, not trucks. The analysts have revised their forecast, and now they're forecasting a very, very sharp decline of the sales of diesel cars in Europe. And in 2030, now the forecast is that the diesel cars and light utility vehicles will represent only 1.2 million of cars. So most of the market will be with electrical hybrids, plug-in hybrids, and gasoline cars. I have discussed with some people from the oil companies in Europe, especially the French Total company. So they didn't question those figures. They agree with those figures and with the trend. But they made a very good remark that those figures are concerning only the cars and the light utility vehicles, not the trucks. And with the growth of the transport activity, the demand for diesel will increase, and hopefully compensate the decline for the cars and light utility vehicles. But they added, unless technological breakthrough, which might happen, because now there are some already some trials in US and Europe of electrical trucks, autonomous electrical trucks, also with fuel cells. So the diesel for trucks might remain at the same level, but if any technological breakthrough in the autonomy or the things, it might precipitate the decline of the diesel use also for trucks. Another slide showing the sharp decline of the diesel cars in Europe. In 2015, when the Dieselgate started at Volkswagen, diesel cars, the sale of diesel cars were representing more than 50%. In 2030, it will be just a few percent, so really a niche market. I've already presented this slide, but I would like to insist on it, that our CTO industry is more than 100 years old. It's a sustainable, non-subsidized, bio-based industry. The biodiesel production out of CTO is really destroying a precious resource. With the Dieselgate, diesel technology is questioned in many countries. There is a possible ban of diesel cars in European cities. It might be already in Paris in 2020, which is tomorrow. And as I mentioned, the diesel for trucks, if possible breakthrough of other technologies to precipitate the decline. And finally, fractionalizing CTO and upgrading the European products following the principle of cascading is really the most efficient and intelligent way to of using crude alloy. And to conclude, an outlook for the pine chemical market. There is a high demand for CST in octopentyne from the flavor and fragrance, solvent, and resin industries. But cost consideration might force users to switch to alternative products, which is a risk. I am mentioning also D-limonen, because D-limonen can be used in some applications, some end use, like in terpene resin, as an alternative to alpha and beta pinene. But the two main countries producers are Brazil, number one, and Florida. But in those two countries, the crop is affected by climatic conditions and diseases. For instance, last year in Florida, Hurricane Irma destroyed 30% of the crop. This year, the crop is growing by 55%, which is a good news, but it's only one-third of the production 20 years ago. In Brazil, this year, the crop is suffering from high temperature and dryness. In addition, in both countries, they have to fight against diseases, which has a cost, because now the cost of fighting the diseases is something like $900 per hectare, while 10 years ago, it was only one-third, $300 per hectare to fight the diseases. Hydrocarbon resins becoming commodities, affecting the rosin demand. But once again, we have to insist on the advantages of the rosin derivatives. And for this, I agree with Jonathan's presentation that yesterday, that rosin esters have still a good future. TOFA demand is still high. For instance, driven in US by the North America by the oil field production. Also, once again, the advantage of the crude alloy compared to the other vegetable oil, for instance, the carbon footprint of TOFA is at least 10 times lower than the carbon footprint of vegetable oils fatty acid, other vegetable oils fatty acid. And finally, to conclude on an optimistic way, The pine chemical market is growing at a, still growing at a higher rate than the GDP growth, and the demand driven by Asia, where are most of the new industrial projects. And hopefully, the growing environmental concern will favor the pine chemicals. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you.